Hola, me llamo Carl Baloney Jr. y soy el vicepresidente y director de defensa de AIDS United. Bienvenido a AIDSWatch. Estamos muy contentos de que se haya unido a nosotros hoy. Hi, my name is Carl Baloney Jr. and I'm the Vice President and Chief Advocacy Officer here at AIDS United. Welcome to AIDSWatch. We are so glad to have you join us today. Escuche atentamente a la información sobre los servicios de traducción. Seleccione su idioma usando el botón de interpretación en forma de globo terráqueo. Si usted está usando su computadora, el botón de interpretación se encuentra ubicado en la parte inferior derecha de su pantalla. Si usted no desea escuchar la narración en inglés de fondo una vez que haya seleccionado su idioma, vaya a la opción Menú y selección Silenciar audio original. Si usted está usando un dispositivo móvil, Android o Apple, haga clic en los tres puntos ubicados en los controles de la reunión y selección Interpretación del idioma, luego selección Español. Si usted no desea escuchar la narración en inglés de fondo, selección Silenciar el audio. Gracias. Comenzaremos la presentación en breve. Thank you. We will begin the presentation shortly.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Tyler Termier, and I proudly serve as the Chief Executive Officer of Cascade AIDS Project and Prism Health, as well as the co-chair of the AIDS United Public Policy Council. As we continue to navigate and lead through sustained crises in our nation, we have all been hard at work trying to find new, innovative pathways to expanding access to those we serve and all those who have traditionally been furthest from opportunity. This road has not always been easy, but as traditional AIDS service organizations and community health clinics, we are a resilient people. We have evolved with our movement. We have been nimble and survived one pandemic only to face a second in our lifetimes. We know more than anyone that the last 18 months have not created all new conditions, but rather highlighted and made more visible the systemic issues faced by our communities. Food and housing instability, poverty, failing educational systems, racism, oppression, and inaccessible healthcare, only to name a few. Each issues that seem insurmountable on their own, each continuing to fuel the HIV epidemic. So what do we need to do? We need a federal solution that closes the Medicaid gap for the millions of people left uninsured because their states refuse to expand Medicaid eligibility. We need vigilant monitoring and enforcement of healthcare coverage to ensure affordable and accessible coverage of HIV prevention, treatment, and services, particularly in communities that have disparate access and uptake of critical interventions such as pre-exposure prophylaxis, or PrEP. We need expanded services in all public health care, including Medicare and Medicaid, and private health insurance that are tailored to the unique prevention, care, and treatment needs of older people living with HIV and long-term survivors. We need healthcare financing structures that are flexible enough to support efforts that address social determinants of health, including programs that address housing and food security, mental health and drug user health, non-emergency medical transportation, and community health worker services. We need increased funding and program flexibilities within Medicaid and Medicare as the COVID-19 pandemic exacerbates disparities within our healthcare system. We need continued attention to the healthcare and social needs of people living with HIV who experience the long-term effects of the COVID-19 pandemic. To end the HIV epidemic in our nation, we must end HIV in the Southern United States. Thank you for your time, for all of the effort you continue to put in each and every day for our communities. Please enjoy the fall edition of AIDS Watch 2021.
everyone, and welcome back to the first day of our Fall 2021 AIDS Watch. We're so happy that you decided to join us today on National Gay Men's HIV and AIDS Awareness Day and have taken time out of your busy schedule to engage in advocacy on behalf of people living with and vulnerable to HIV. My name is Phil Waters, and I'm a clinical instructor at the Center for Health Law and Policy Innovation at Harvard Law School and a member of the Treatment Access Expansion Project co-organizing this AIDS Watch. I am thrilled to serve as the moderator for this panel discussion on healthcare access. Today's panel is really meant to help contextualize some of the asks related to healthcare in your policy brief that Tyler so eloquently delivered to you just now, and to connect the dots between HIV and healthcare access as it relates to various topics like Medicaid expansion, the care needs of older people living with HIV, and the integration of the social aspects of healthcare. Joining me today are three fantastic panelists that can speak to their own experiences working in advocacy on these very issues. First off, I'd like to introduce Linda Dixon. Linda serves as the Health Law Director at the Mississippi Center for Justice, a position she's held since November of 2008. Prior to joining the center, she was the Assistant Secretary of State for Elections for the Mississippi Secretary of State's office, where she previously held the position of Senior Attorney and Director of Elections, Trainings, and Education. She received a Bachelor of Science degree in Criminal Justice from Southern University at New Orleans and her law degree from Mississippi College School of Law. Linda's work focuses on access to healthcare and HIV discrimination and stigma. Linda's a member of the Mississippi Bar and the Magnolia Bar Association. Thank you for joining us, Linda. Second, joining us today is Christina Adelike. Christina is a social justice advocate and attorney who uses her truly insatiable curiosity to drive work towards creating a better world for all, especially members of vulnerable and historically underserved communities. Christina serves as the policy and communications manager for the North Carolina AIDS Action Network, where she meaningfully engages people living with HIV and impacting communities, including communities of color, rural communities, people living with hepatitis, people who use drugs, and LGBTQ plus people. Christina also monitors state and federal legislative and administrative activity and actively participates in various policy coalitions and committees focused on issues impacting people living with or affected by HIV. Prior to her time at NCAN, Christina served as the coalition organizer at Equality North Carolina. Thank you for joining us, Christina. And last but not least, I'd like to introduce Moises Augusto Rosario. Moises is a longtime treatment advocate and educator for people living with HIV. Moises has played a crucial role in ensuring that communities of color have equal access to care, treatment, and life-saving information, and has won numerous awards for his work with the HIV community. Moises is currently the director of treatment for NMAC, and he is an active member of the District of Columbia for AIDS Research Community Partnership Council. He's also a member of the Community Advisory Board of the Delaney AIDS Research Enterprise to help find a cure, part of the NIH-sponsored Martin Delaney Collaboratories for HIV Cure Research. Previously, he worked as a program manager for the International Treatment Preparedness Coalition with the HIV Collaborative Fund for HIV Treatment Preparedness. And before his tenure at ITPC, Moises was the Vice President and Managing Director for Community Access, a Nelson's Communication Company, and member of the Publicist Healthcare Group. All right, well, thank you all for joining us and for lending your expertise to what I hope will be a very dynamic discussion. Before we get started and I stop talking, one quick housekeeping note. Our panelists have graciously agreed to try and make this more of a dynamic discussion. And so if you have relevant questions about what anyone's talking about along the way, we'd be happy to address it as we're talking. But that means that you, the audience, has to please use the question and answer box to submit those questions. While the chat is really great and we love all these shout outs and love this discussion amongst yourself, it's really hard to follow from our end. So please submit your questions to the Q&A box and we'll either address them as we go along or turn to any we didn't get with the remaining time left over at the end. All right, panelists, let's get started by talking about everyone's favorite subject, Medicaid. I know at least a couple of you reside in states right now that have not expanded their Medicaid programs. So I just want to have a sort of open question and ask, what would Medicaid expansion mean, nationwide Medicaid expansion mean for the work that you are doing and the networks of people that you're serving? Why don't we start with Linda?
Thank you, Phil. And I appreciate Tyler laid it out in his introduction and welcome of the panel. You know, Mississippi is one of 12 states in the country that has not expanded Medicaid. And eight of those states are in the South. The number one benefit, of course, is the health and well-being of Mississippians and Americans, all over the country in states that have not expanded Medicaid. We know that expanding Medicaid gives those adults who are not covered, who are uninsured, greater access to healthcare. It also means that it helps to support the rural hospitals all over the state of Mississippi who are at risk of closure. We know some have closed. 51% of Mississippians, at least 51%, live in rural areas of the state. So when you're talking about access, we're also looking at from a geographical standpoint. We don't have a public transportation system here in the state of Mississippi. We have in the capital city of Jackson, there's public transportation, but that is another factor that we have to consider for people having access and being able to get to healthcare providers. And another point to raise is job creation. We know that with expanded Medicaid, it's going to help with the economy. We know that we're going to need people to fill those positions to help serve all those uninsured people. In Mississippi, we're talking about 200,000 people who would gain access if our state expanded Medicaid. And in respect to people living with HIV, there's a recent report from the AIDS Institute. According to that report, 2,420 people living with HIV in Mississippi are uninsured. So we're talking about a lot of folks who would definitely have greater access and who deserve to have healthcare.
Thanks, Linda. Other panelists want to answer that question as well?
Yeah, I'll go ahead and chime in. Unfortunately, like Mississippi, North Carolina is also a state that has not expanded Medicaid. And that has led and contributed to folks being able to access only their HIV medication, which is great, but it fails to take into account that people living with HIV may have other comorbidities or medical health issues that they're needing to address. And so being able to have Medicaid expansion will be able to help address all of the other additional healthcare needs that may come up. And I think it's particularly important for folks who are aging with HIV. I think that at this point in the epidemic, we are seeing larger amounts of folks who have been living with HIV for a considerable amount of time. And, you know, with aging, unfortunately, comes a lot of other healthcare issues that could arise up. And so being able to have Medicaid expansion, especially for people living with HIV, is particularly impactful to be able to address all of the old people illnesses that we have to address, which is, you know, it sucks to think about, but then it's also really exciting. Because, you know, 30 years ago, we would have never thought that we would be in this position to where we would have to, you know, figure out a new strategy to help folks aging with HIV. So I think it's an exciting development.
Hi. Thank you, Christina, for mentioning the aging population. And I think, I mean, I want to expand a little more about the situation that the elder living with HIV over 50 is going to face, actually is starting to face at this point. I mean, as we know, this group constitute half of the people living with HIV. And in a few years, it would be, you know, 70%. I think like in 2030, maybe like 70% of the people living with HIV that are over the age of 50 and, you know, aging. The issue that is so critical is that people, this is the first cohort of people living with HIV that are aging. Therefore, we don't have a lot of information about, you know, what does that mean in terms of the biology of living for so many years with the virus for those that are long-term survivors, also the long-term effects of the medication, and then, you know, having to face inflammation due to, you know, the constant replication of the virus in the reservoir. So all those components may the person aging with HIV more vulnerable to, for example, develop comorbidities like Christina mentioned, but in the case of people living with HIV, we're seeing those comorbidities earlier than people that are not HIV positive. Like people have it in their 65, 60, and we're seeing people with HIV facing serious comorbidities in their 40s and 50s. The reason why I explain that is because the Ryan White program, for example, which is healthcare system for people living with HIV is not prepared to deal with these issues regarding aging. We don't have a standard of care that has been revised, so we make sure that a screening happened early on for those that, you know, are in their 50s and may be facing comorbidities. So because Ryan White is not prepared, you know, when people that have to deal with or live in places where Medicaid is not expanded, you know, as Christina also mentioned, the ability for these individuals, if they're not in Ryan White because they may not qualify, or they don't qualify for Medicaid because they make too much money, like that gap, a lot of people aging with HIV may fall through that crack. And, you know, and that would make it very, very dangerous, because we're talking about health systems that will be, the utilization will be increased. And not just with, you know, simple aging things, but serious comorbidities. So this is a very serious issue that we need to tackle now.
Thank you all. I'd like to sort of broaden the discussion now and bring up some more things beyond the healthcare system, so to speak. So I think we all know that we need Medicaid expansion and access to health coverage, but what kind of barriers are you seeing in terms of capacity to get hard to reach populations engaged in the healthcare system? Or really stated another way, what kind of barriers to healthcare are people seeing outside of the traditional lack of access to healthcare?
I can start real quick. You know, one thing that I've heard from a lot of folks, which really sucks, is just that their healthcare providers are mean to them and, you know, are dismissive of their needs. And, you know, that has led folks to dropping out of care, dropping out of treatment. You know, I think if you are going to take time out of your day, leave work, hop on the bus, you know, to get to your appointment, and, you know, you get there and you're mistreated, that gets in the way. That could end up killing someone if, you know, we're not even giving a basal level of care to our patients. That needs to stop. And unfortunately, especially in the HIV space, there have been instances where providers have been very stigmatizing to folks. And that's, I consider that to be a huge barrier.
I can go, or Linda? Okay, I mean, I just want to mention, you know, we have access to care, for example, in communities of color has been an issue that has been around, you know, even before we had to deal with HIV. And I think, like, you know, health disparities is just, you know, one of the things that we have been dealing with, in which people, you know, for African American communities or Latino communities have not had like the same kind of access or the same quality of care that other communities that have a better financial situation, to mention one, you know, or, you know, other social determinants of health. Like, we know when we look at communities of color and we look at these disparities, they have to do basically a lot with, you know, people not having transportation or people not having food at the table, or, you know, if we're talking about something more pervasive, some the medical mistrust that we find, you know, and with enough reason in the African-American community, like in the Latino community. So these are serious systemic obstacles that don't allow, and this is something that come, you know, decades and decades and decades and decades. It's not something that just happened a year ago. So, you know, tackling this, you know, it's a big challenge, and it that is systematic. So it has to be looked from different points within the spectrum of healthcare.
Real quick, I did want to add real quick, because I forgot to mention it earlier, but another thing that I think, you know, can serve as a barrier for folks is providers not being able to take into account you know, people who have been living with HIV for a long time and the trauma history that could carry. You know, I think, you know, I've heard of providers complaining about folks not wanting to stay in treatment and how that's problematic, but they may not know that they may have tried a HIV medication in the 80s that didn't jive with them that well. And maybe that trauma is real. You know, medications are different now, so it may not be that person isn't compliant, but they may have some history that they're dealing with. So I think being able to have that context for providers to be able to know how to talk to folks, I think is helpful.
And I'll add that, you know, we know that health disparities and racial inequities lead to poor health outcomes. When we look at the resources, are they evenly distributed? Do people really know about all the resources that's available to them? Do they have transportation, which we've all already acknowledged, to get there? And how does that really look? When you look at the social determinants of health, you can just go down the list and see how all of the social determinants of health are barriers to people accessing healthcare. And we also have to acknowledge how much of this is rooted in stigma as it pertains to people living with HIV. Stigma manifests itself in so many different ways, and healthcare is no different from any other place where we see stigma. So I think it's important to, you know, really look at the essence and you know, branch out from there and look at the social determinants of health and how people are truly able to access healthcare in reality.
Pick up on that thread of the social determinants of health, because I think, you know, we all agree that access to treatment is important, but the quality of that treatment, and by extension, the quality of life of individuals, is really what we're seeking to improve, as mentioned earlier today. What kind of things do you all hope we can start incorporating into the healthcare system as a way to measure the quality of life for people living with HIV that's beyond just viral suppression? And perhaps we can pick up on some of the threads that our esteemed panelists earlier that they laid out for us very easily.
I'm going to add, like you mentioned now, you know, something is so critical, you know, that people think that the standard, you know, that what the person with HIV need is viral suppression, undetectable viral load, they won't be able to transmit, and, you know, they will stay healthier, and that's great, right? That's great, but that is not enough. It's not enough for the communities that have been in disadvantage, and it's not going to be enough for those that are aging with HIV, in which viral suppression is, you know, it's just going to be one component of all the healthcare needs that they will have in terms of non-communicable diseases, cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, arthritis, bone density. There are all these other issues that go beyond viral suppression, and people that have had like undetectable viral load and still developing comorbidities due to, you know, the reasons that we have already mentioned. So, you know, social determinants of health needs to be addressed, you know, to impact the quality of care, so people are compelled, you know, to trust the system, are compelled to utilize the system that is available to them and the resources that are available to them in a way that is comprehensive, and that the individual is looked as a whole person, you know, in which all these other determinants are taken into consideration to impact not only, you know, the years lived, but also the quality of those years.
Yes, absolutely agree to everything you just said. You know, when I think about the social determinants of health and how we can access healthcare differently, you know, I hope that and you know, we'd like to see more of a holistic approach in the healthcare system and truly meeting people where they are with their needs. You know, in Mississippi, currently we have a medical legal partnership, an HIV medical legal partnership that's aimed at assisting individuals living with HIV with employment discrimination, housing discrimination, privacy violations. We have this collaboration with the Mississippi State Department of Health. And our goal is to offer legal support to individuals in areas to promote healthy outcomes. And we found that treatment encompasses more than, of course, medical procedures and medicine to measure the quality of life for people living with HIV. You know, you don't know you have a legal issue until you do. So part of what we're doing is to make people aware of their legal issues and support them when they're newly diagnosed and otherwise to make sure that they know what these areas really look like. So I think it's important to just, you know, meet people where they are and support them holistically, whatever that means for them.
Yes. Yes, I completely agree with what Linda and Moises both said. I think that thinking about people living with HIV as whole people is so important. And I wish that we, you know, as advocates, as, you know, government agencies that are tasked with funding, you know, HIV programs, we need to, you know, kind of recalibrate our standards of care and prioritize quality of life right up there with viral suppression and health out, like physical health outcomes. Because if we ignore all of the things that are surrounding a person and then are only focusing on viral suppression, you're going to miss a lot of context as to, you know, what's contributing to those health outcomes. So I don't know if that looks like tying funding to, you know, quality of life outcomes in addition to viral suppression outcomes, if there's something that, you know, state governments, federal governments can do to kind of enforce that. Because I think that, you know, I think if you were to ask any Ryan White planning body, they're going to be like, of course, we're taking into account quality of life, but that's not actually in practice happening. So I think that being able to somehow strong arm folks into doing the right thing, I think could be one way.
Well, one quick comment about quality of life. I think it would be important for us also to sit down and think what quality of life actually means for the person living with HIV, right? And I think about like the age spectrum, right? Like quality of life for people with HIV that have been able to take a pill once a day, that are, you know, in their 20s and 30s, you know, their ability to have a more rich or better quality of life compared to, you know, those that are in their 40s and 50s that are starting to deal with issues of polypharmacy, for example, people that are living with HIV that are facing other comorbidities and the side effects of, you know, that polypharmacy. So the person with HIV in their 60s is different than the person in their 70s, is different than the person in their 80s, and is different as the younger generation of people living with HIV. So it's not going to be one size fits all, but I think it's time for us to start having that conversation, right? Not wait until we have the silver tsunami of people aging with HIV, you know, crowding, you know, like really utilizing systems. So we need to have that kind of discussion about what really quality of life means for people living with HIV.
And I absolutely love that. You know, you have to reassess what those needs are because they are changing and evolving. And as you said, what was once in maybe the 20s and 30 years of age is going to look different. So, you know, how do we do that? And mm-hmm. I think that's where just looking at the person as a whole and not just by their status, or, you know, people come with all kinds of needs. And so I appreciate you saying that and raising that.
Linda, you gave us a great example, but I'd like to ask the, you know, the whole panel if they have thoughts about this as well. You know, we're talking about the social determinants of health and additional needs that need to be met to address all of our community's needs. But maybe folks could give us a bit of an example about how your organizations or networks that you are connected with are working towards those needs. So Linda, you gave us a great example of the medical legal partnership as one of those things. I don't know if y'all have another one, or maybe Christina and Moises could also give an example of something that you've encountered or that you're directly working on.
No, and I can just expand that a little more to even talk about HIV criminalization just a bit, and you know, what that really does and how it affects not just people who are diagnosed, but those who need to be tested, and how it it prevents people from getting tested. It keeps them away from that if we have laws on the books that you know, will criminalize somebody for you know, living with HIV. So I think that's one area of work that we are doing, as well as stigma, both internalized stigma and just stigma generally, and how stigma prevents people from accessing care, how it deters them from getting tested. So I just wanted to raise those issues as well that we you know, work with our partner organizations and networks in Mississippi.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, you know, in addition to what Linda brought up, I think, you know, I've also in North Carolina, we've experienced a lot of complaints from people living with HIV around discrimination, around HIV criminalization. I think there's a lot of those issues that are still persisting. And, you know, sometimes those, that discrimination serves as a barrier from accessing housing or other types of services. So we've seen that. But I think that, you know, one thing that our organization does a lot of work on is housing advocacy. You know, I think if you're experiencing homelessness or you're housing insecure, you're not going to be prioritizing getting an HIV test or getting into treatment or staying in treatment. You're not going to be prioritizing thinking of that. You're going to be thinking about, you know, surviving. And so making sure that housing isn't something that people living with HIV have to worry about is something that we advocate a lot around, and just addressing the issues around poverty. And, you know, I think that, you know, as a small nonprofit, like, we can't fix poverty for everyone, but we can do what we can to make sure that when we have folks, particularly folks living with HIV, who are dedicating their services or their time, we always make sure to compensate folks the best that we can. And, you know, not just, you know, loosey goosey, but in a way that could actually be beneficial. I know some folks, you know, can't make too much money to continue receiving certain benefits. So, like, we're very mindful of how we go about giving money and just making sure that, you know, we're not disrupting folks and, like, their access to other resources while trying to help them, you know, build their finances up. So I think just being a little intentional about, you know, not necessarily trying to fix everything and everyone, but being able to impact folks that you can.
So from the INMAC, you know, we are a national organization, so we have the ability to work with other communities locally around the country. And we have the, you know, the United States Conference on AIDS, in which we bring, you know, it's like the gathering of the HIV community to learn, to exchange ideas, to network on all these issues that we were talking about, and even more. In terms of the specifics, we have programs that address stigma at the Center to AIDS Aid, that which is one of our divisions. They also have the block, which is to train leadership on people of color living with HIV. And the other two programs that I think are relevant to what we've been talking about, the specific communities most effective of that will get you know, affected in terms of access to care. We have the HIV 50 plus, a strong and healthy program. And this is a program in which every year we bring 50 people living with HIV over the age of 50, and we immerse them in a number of educational programs through the United States Conference on AIDS, but through the whole year, you know, we provide webinars, and we also provide with mini grants so they can do activities in their community to educate, but also to mobilize community. We have been working with this group in the past year to put together the national network of individuals aging and living with HIV, which it was launched two weeks ago. And the idea behind this is that for the issues that we've been talking about in terms of access to care for the aging community living with HIV, we're going to have to build, I want to build an army of individuals living with HIV and aging, right? That they, we're going to need to mobilize the community, organize it to, you know, advocate at the Congress level, at the local level, at the district level, to bring up the issues, you know, with the great tradition of the Denver principles that we have, you know, from the beginning of this epidemic. So we are working, you know, in my case specifically with those living with HIV and those that are aging, and kind of combining how we can upgrade the health literacy of this community, at the same time provide them with the structure to do the advocacy work that is going to be needed in order to, you know, upgrade and modernize the health systems for them.
Thanks. This next question I'll ask you to sort of start off, Moises, but it's for the whole panel. You know, you're talking about the older population of people living with HIV. What does it mean to you to have services that are tailored to support the unique prevention, care, and treatment needs specifically of older people living with HIV and longer-term survivors?
Sure. I mean, I'm an older person living with HIV to start with, and I tested in 86. And, you know, and I think it means a lot in the sense that I know the definite, you know, services in terms of aging, but aging with HIV, you know, bring another layer of issues that we're going to have to tailor or create those kind of services for this community. We want to make sure, as we talked before, we increase their quality of life. So when we age, we don't have to, you know, when you think, and I think like as a person with HIV, right? Like when I got into my 40s and the treatments for HIV were getting better, for a moment I thought, oh, what a relief. I don't have to take like all these pills and deal with all these things. And then what happened when I turned 50, suddenly I have again, polypharmacy. I had to, you know, go to more doctor visits, something that I thought it was going to, you know, be better as I age it. But, you know, and I don't complain. I'm an optimist. You know, I don't like to be a victim in that regard. But I think it is important that we feel that we're not forgetting the person aging with HIV, you know, and that as we take into account prevention services for the younger, that we also think about the older. I mean, people still have sex in their 60s, 70s, 80s, and a high percentage of people that just have turned HIV positive are people over the age of 50. So that is, you know, that is something for us to take into consideration when we talk about also prevention services. So, you know, it just means for us to make sure that we age with dignity and with the care and the services that this amazing community, you know, of service providers have offered us for the past 30 years. So that continues in the next 20, 30 more years.
Yeah, I think that Moises definitely like said a lot there, and I agree with everything that he said. I just think that, you know, we already have existing structures in place to address the needs of aging people. And I think that we need to build off of that and make sure that people living with HIV are included. You know, if we need to be talking to folks at CMS or with, you know, nursing home associations or whoever we need to be talking to, whatever structures are already existing, I think we need to be building off of that.
And I'll just add that we just need to be very intentional about assessing those needs, really finding out what those needs are, not what we think, but what they tell us the needs are. I think that's very, very important of the aging population. And assessing, in particular, their legal needs will definitely change. It's going to look a little different. And then, of course, connecting them to resources, I think is crucial. As Christina said, whether it's, you know, reaching out to CMS or whomever, just to make sure that that we're being very intentional to meet the needs of the aging population.
Just to piggyback a little bit on that, one important thing also is to look at geriatric services within healthcare, but also geriatric social workers. We are in need of geriatric care in this country in general. You know, there is a shortage of geriatric doctors. And as we face that, we also need to make sure that that is available for people living with HIV aging, combining with their standard of care for HIV. And at the same time, also like home long-term care are issues that, you know, Medicare doesn't pay for that, I think. And we need to start like looking for those kind of, you know, home, you know, nursing homes, care at home, all these things that, you know, people aging will need, and that are still now at this point, even, you know, with the general populations are challenging to have. Look at what happened with COVID and the people, you know, 60s and up.
Thanks, everyone. So we've talked a lot about treatment. Let's make sure to talk a little bit about prevention and PrEP. I want to ask, what do you see as the needed policy changes in order to make sure that PrEP sees more uptake in the communities that you're working in?
Go ahead, Christina, go ahead.
I was just going to say like something super obvious, but I think that we do need more education about PrEP out there, both for providers and just the general public. I think that we in the HIV space, like, hear PrEP every day, all day, and we're so almost desensitized to it. But if you talk about PrEP to just anyone in your real life, you're going to find someone who's like, I don't know what that is. Even if they're, you know, healthcare providers, and even if they do, they may have a very stigmatized version or idea as to what PrEP is, who PrEP is for. There's a lot of conspiracy theories about side effects and stuff like that. So I think being able to get accurate information about PrEP to not only providers, but to populations who would benefit from it, and just in the broader public to help alleviate some of that stigma, I think it's important. And then also for folks who don't have healthcare insurance or covered by Medicaid, how are they going to be able to access PrEP? I think that some local jurisdictions have funding set aside to help address, you know, not only accessing the PrEP medication, but all the lab visits and stuff, but not every jurisdiction is set up that way. So especially for folks in the South who may be in a state that haven't expanded Medicaid, there are still barriers in place. Even though recently there was that guidance that was sent out that was directing insurance companies to be able to cover PrEP and the testing and all that associated with that. But that only helps folks if they have insurance, you know, for folks who don't have insurance are able to benefit from that. So being able to address those barriers for folks is key too.
And I totally agree. I mean, when you said the obvious, it's the obvious for me too, which is education. I think, you know, as you pose the question, Phil, the first thing that came to my mind is education. And really getting out there and normalizing the conversation around sex, normalizing the conversation around HIV and PrEP, and just the stigma. We have to, you know, that's another issue that we're gonna have to deal with. And, you know, the lack of access of healthcare with people who are not insured. What does that really look like? I mean, to really think about how do you get that into the hands of people who don't have access, who are not educated about it, I think it's a multi-layered layers of barriers that we have to address with PrEP.
Yeah, I would like to add to what you said, like taking into consideration the interconnectivity of all these issues that we're talking about. You know, it's like, for example, when you think about PrEP, when it came out, it was this great technology and changing the paradigm, you know, and all of that. And when you look at, you know, the populations that had benefited the most, or that, you know, even with all the, and I think education is paramount, and I agree with the two of you, but even with all the awareness and education program that has been offered out there, gay men of color are still, you know, are slowly increasing the uptake. But, you know, you see that the majority of the people that have access and have benefit are, you know, white gay men. And we need to figure out, you know, understanding that is also the health systems that may not be ready, or they need to be prepared or improve to make sure that gay men of color have access to PrEP in the way, you know, that they in the way that respond to where they are in their lives, right? Like, we cannot pretend that, you know, going to your doctor and get a prescription is translate to the same relationship of care that the gay men of color is going to have. You know, probably they don't even have a doctor. I worry a little bit also about, you know, we have soon going to see, you know, long acting injectables used for PrEP. And, you know, and they sound amazing, once a month, once every 2 months. And even we're going to have some oral medications that are going to be taken orally just every month or something like that. But if you think, my concern is, as we improve, we increase the technology, this also exacerbate the health disparities, right? We haven't still solved how we're going to get the once a pill PrEP to the gay men of color. And now we're going to have long-term injectables for PrEP. So, you know, that we consciously, you know, start talking, you know, in advance on how we're going to make sure, for example, that the technology advances with the long-term injectables are going to benefit, you know, other communities that usually will not benefit from it, or they would fall behind. And it, you know, this requires, not everybody's going to be able to get an injection on their own. They're going to have to go to a pharmacy, or they'd have to arrange, you know, somehow to get these injections. And we need to think about how our systems are ready for that, for everybody, right? Not just for those that have access to healthcare.
Mm-hmm. And Moises, you brought up something that triggered something in my mind, you know, when it came to, you know, the injectable PrEP and just all the different forms of PrEP that are now available. It's almost like science is almost taking like too many steps too quickly, instead of like waiting for folks to be able to even know what PrEP is. But I think that that's exciting. But I think that it provides an opportunity to be able to think about other communities and other populations who need PrEP, who are often left out of the conversation. You know, when we think about women, we know that Black women are disproportionately impacted by HIV, could absolutely benefit from PrEP. And, you know, some women are used to taking a pill every day already. That's not a new concept for them. And there are also, when you think about like birth control, there are already mechanisms and structures in place to be able to provide different modes of contraception. So let's say we have the one pill a day, we have the injection situation. So it's like, we have that infrastructure already in place. Now we need to incorporate PrEP, incorporate PEP, and normalize those conversations, because there are a lot of people who don't get to benefit from PrEP because it's like, they don't even know.
One thing about women that is so important, and we need to talk about women, and we need to make sure we bring that to our policy discussion, is that also, you know, research on PrEP needs to, you know, include women, right? Like even for Truvada, it couldn't be approved for women because the research was not there. You know, they didn't recruit enough women. You know, so also as we think about the system, we need to think about the research and how is it structured and who is having access to clinical trials. And we make sure that women have, you know, that these trials, if they need to have a percentage of women and if they don't reach it, they have to stop and wait until they have it to do the trial. Let's do it. But we cannot go on not having, you know, participation or data, sufficient data on women on PrEP. This is something really sad and serious, a serious problem that women face.
I'm going to turn us to a question that came in through the Q&A box. And just a reminder, if you have questions, please submit through the question and answer box. I love all this chat and peer education going on in the chat, but really hard for us to follow. So a question from Ramon Gardenhire. According to GLAAD's 2021 State of HIV Stigma Report, HIV awareness is low. Out of about 2,500 adult residents in the U.S. interviewed, only 48% felt they knew anything about HIV in general. And today, 9 years after Truvada has been approved, only about 64% of people know about it. How do you think this low awareness impacts policy and legislative efforts?
It makes it hard. I feel like oftentimes we're having to start from scratch when we're having meetings. They're just like, let's prep. And it's like, oh, okay. So we have to like back it up. And depending on who you're talking to, you know, there's, like we've been talking about before, a lot of stigma around PrEP, who should be using PrEP, and even navigating those kinds of conversations in the South or, you know, with certain populations is really challenging, and that definitely impacts policy. You know, if you have policymakers who are shoving an agenda that's very, as they claim or allege, very pro-family, very, you know, anti-sex or whatever their agenda is, you know, that definitely harms policy when it comes to being able to let folks know about PrEP, thinking about populations who would benefit from PrEP. So yeah, all of that ties together.
Yeah, you know, we have to educate policymakers, you know, people and other stakeholders, people who are at the table, to make them understand. And sometimes, you know, we've had to start at HIV 101, transmission, care, treatment, prevention. We starting from ground zero to get to the technology and modernization of medicines to help save people's lives, you know, and just people generally. So I think, you know, that's really important, is being able to educate people generally on what it, you know, what this is all about. And, you know, we can't, you know, and I bring up stigma again, because we know that stigma really prevents some real conversations from happening for people to get past how beneficial and impactful in a wonderful way this can be for people.
Absolutely agree with both of you. And, you know, one of the biggest issues that people, you know, consider, we, you know, people have been living a good life, but this perception that HIV is under control, that is, you know, another chronic disease that, you know, with treatment, people just, you know, go on with the life like everybody else. I mean, it's harming us in the sense that that narrative doesn't allow people to see beyond, you know, of that public narrative about people with HIV. They already have treatments and they're great. No, we're not. I mean, this is still a communicable disease. You know, it's get transmitted through sex. We have high rates of infection among, you know, people of color to start with and gay men of all races. And so we haven't solved the problem. We haven't, you know, even with the treatments that we have, and now that we are seeing again, the aging group being the majority that is gonna face all these other issues and comorbidities, you know, HIV, we need to make sure that we build a narrative that really show, you know, what is, you know, why HIV is so important in policy, and that, you know, whatever advocacy efforts that we have, you know, so the treatments continue to improve, but also the care and the prevention, that is not a sub problem and it's not a chronic disease like many other diseases. We still are in the middle of not being able to end it or complete, you know, having the epidemic to, you know, being in a place in which it's not so out of control, but that we can aim to end the epidemic, you know, in the near future.
Let's make sure we talk about COVID-19 for a second, everyone's favorite subject these days. So Harold Phillips mentioned earlier that, you know, we saw a tremendous amount of flexibility given to the healthcare system to respond to the COVID-19 pandemic. And we found that much of that flexibility benefited people living with HIV, such that we want to make sure those flexibilities stay around. What kind of policy, funding, program flexibilities would you like to see preserved? And if they haven't been implemented, what kind of things do you still think we need to adequately tackle the needs of people living with HIV that are dealing with the long-term effects of COVID?
You know, yeah, COVID-19 magnified the health disparities and racial inequities we already knew existed. And I would like to see health disparities and racial inequities addressed in a meaningful and impactful way to help lessen the divide that existed before COVID-19. And to keep any and everything, and I'm just, that's broad and it's not really specific, because I think anything that was done to help lessen COVID-19, from testing to access in medication to services, housing, you know, a lot of the social determinants of health that was addressed. I saw people call this number for transportation. You know, people who don't have transportation for COVID-19, they don't have transportation any other time. People who have issues accessing healthcare, they still have issues accessing healthcare before and after COVID. So how do we keep these things in place? Expanding Medicaid is one of those ways we can do that. Making sure people have affordable housing, quality healthcare, that we have the education we need, that we, and this is a big ask to how do we eradicate stigma when we're doing all of this, even in the services that are provided for people living with HIV. So we know it can be done. We've seen it with COVID-19, even the way it was politicized. I won't go there because I'm not going to go there, but in terms of just, you know, what we can do, we can continue to be intentional about HIV, the services, prevention, testing, housing, transportation, and all the aging, what's going to happen, you know, trending out for the aging population. And I just appreciate having that conversation here, just, you know, what's going to happen? Thinking about, you know, even from, I've already raised from a legal standpoint, people may need wills, powers of attorneys, whatever the case may be, to be proactive and thinking about what individuals will need and how we can maintain what we have.
Mm-hmm. What came to my mind was removing a lot of the red tape that exists around, you know, government programs, whether it be Medicaid and requiring folks to come in person to sign something. And it's like, why do we need to be doing that? That's never convenient for anybody. I don't think we needed COVID to tell us that, but I think just being able to continue to remove barriers that seem unnecessary, that makes complete sense. I think being able to keep the increased access to telehealth and having insurance companies be okay with that and funding that, I think that's important, especially we've talked about transportation a lot and those issues have existed prior to COVID and they're still here. So being able to take that piece out and allow folks to access through telehealth and doing what's needed to actually build that infrastructure, whether it's, you know, broadband or whatever folks need, I think that that will be helpful. And I would love to keep, you know, I know it's kind of wishful, but I think being able to keep that priority of wanting to keep people housed. I know during COVID and the HOPWA program really showed out and really provided a model of how to treat people during a pandemic. I think, you know, taking them out of housing is never cool. It's not okay. And so I think being able to apply that way of thinking outside of the pandemic and to the broader community and being able to really prioritize that, I think would be amazing.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, like Linda mentioned that, you know, that COVID kind of exacerbated, you know, and make real the health disparities for us. But also I think the way we've been able to respond to COVID has come from the machine that was created in terms of services, care, and, you know, healthcare to people living with HIV. I mean, like the vaccine, we were able to find such a fast way to get the vaccine, but that vaccine, the research that made us able to be there to where we are, a lot of it came out of, you know, vaccine HIV research. But one thing that I think is important is that we continue to advocate to make sure that there is science going on and clinical trial that give us more information about the biology of COVID in people that are infected with HIV. And though, you know, because of the medications, we may think that our response, if your immune system is strong enough, right, based on your viral load and CD4 cell, that, you know, that if you're exposed, your outcome as a person with HIV would not be that harsh. But, you know, we have to wait until, you know, in March, there was this announcement of a large scale study that was done with people with HIV around the world. And, you know, what they found out is that the outcomes of people that have been infected with HIV, I don't know if it's because the immune system has been battling or for whatever reason, they found that a significant, you know, amount of those living with HIV that were exposed, their disease manifested, you know, harsh and difficult. So I think that for people with HIV, it would be important for us to consider that we keep informed, and also that, you know, we people said, well, you know, breakthrough, you get vaccinated and, you know, you will not get that sick. But, you know, to start with, I don't want that in my body because of the long terms of COVID. We don't know. Right. And then I said, oh, OK, so, you know, I mean, I got infected, but I'll be fine. We don't know. So if we can follow right the, you know, the precautions, the mask, and we make sure that we protect even for the infection, even if we're vaccinated, you know, that we do that because, you know, we still don't have a clear answer in terms of like, what does it mean? Right? When you have COVID for a long time.
Thanks, everyone. We have about a half hour left, and I want to highlight that we can submit questions to the Q&A box. And while y'all get your questions in, I'm going to throw a curveball out to our panelists a little bit with a bit of a situation. Say you find yourself in a situation where you are in front of a member of Congress and you have their undivided attention for about 5 minutes. Hopefully this is via Zoom and not in person. And if it's in person, you're wearing a mask. What are maybe two or maximum three things that you want to get across to them in that time? What are three asks that you would prioritize or choose from your own perspective?
Number one, modernize, Ryan White. so we can get Ryan Y up and ready for the aging community living with HIV. Number two, like increase, you know, make sure that the minority AIDS initiative, you know, that we have funded through the Ryan Y actually go to organizations that are of people of color, for people of color, because it was created as such, but it has changed to just give part of those money to organizations that, you know, serve people of color. But we need Congress to re-examine that and make sure the minority AIDS initiative fund people of color organizations. And the third one is to, you know, make sure that, you know, we have a comprehensive prevention strategy that, you know, goes, you know, beyond just clinical, but also we go back to behavioral and integrated that into, you know, even if it's PrEP, even if it's long-term injectables, we need to start talking about the behaviors again, and we need to start talking about sex again. So those, I think, like the three things that I will mention.
Okay, so I'll go next. The first, I think, I would ask them to expand Medicaid just across the board. Let's not make the states leave it up to them, because look where we are in the 12 states who haven't. We are since 2010, 2011? We're still waiting. In complete comprehensive healthcare for people living with HIV. You know, I would ask that every social determinant of health that adversely affects people living with HIV that present a direct correlation to their health is covered. And I mean everything. And I just want to raise and lift mental health. I think that I would ask them to expand services and coverage, and making sure that everyone who desires to have that particular service has it, because I know that that's something that falls by the wayside. You know, it would mean access to comprehensive health coverage that would help the uninsured, you know, secure maybe medical homes where patients are able to identify and even address health concerns, you know, receiving early diagnosis that would allow for treatment. And maintenance for illnesses in their early stages. And, you know, I think it's necessary to have tailored services to ensure that people have more meaningful guidance with achieving healthy outcomes for whatever age you are, for whatever, you know, wherever you live, whatever your transportation issue is, whatever your housing issue is, that you are covered and that it's addressed.
Yes. All right. So I definitely agree with Linda. Medicaid expansion, for sure, for sure. I think the federal government needs to step in and just take charge on that piece. I think that'll help increase resources for a lot of the health issues that were brought up today and then some, especially for folks in the South. I also think I would ask I feel like I would just kind of like lay it all out there and talk about the decriminalization of drugs and start the conversation there. And hopefully that could lead to a conversation to provide increased resources to help, you know, address substance misuse disorder. If folks are wanting to get into treatment, like I think that should be available and we need more resources for that. But that criminal piece, it gets in the way of the healthcare piece. So I feel like that would be, if I could have one thing, that would be it. That's all I'd ask for. Small ask.
Well, I'm really prepared for those. Oh my gosh. Some questions from the chat that came in, rather the Q&A that came in, but remember, please use the question and answer box, not the chat box. Kind of an open-ended question. What is an unexpected policy development or opportunity you have seen in the healthcare access space recently?
Could you rephrase that again?
So somebody asked if there, if you have seen any unexpected or policy developments or opportunities in the healthcare access space, and I'm guessing they're thinking of any that we haven't covered already, because it seems like we've covered a lot.
I feel like, I don't know if it was this past session, but I know that there were federal funds allocated towards syringe exchange programs. I think it was in one of the COVID packages, which was kind of surprising because I feel like that doesn't always happen. So that was a pleasant surprise. And I feel like that hopefully will help lead to like continued support, you know, after COVID. Yeah, because it's weird because I feel like that happened. But then if you look state by state, there were some states that were shutting down their syringe exchange programs. So I feel like it was an interesting tension that we're seeing play out where like the federal government's taking a step forward and then some local jurisdictions are taking a step back.
All right, one more question from the chat, and I think this is more of an informational question. Moises, when you were talking about aging population and the specific care settings, folks were asking if you have or can talk about any statistics on new diagnoses for HIV in geriatric care settings, either rural or urban.
I don't have any specific number at the top of my mind. But yes, we have and continue to have reports of people getting infected with HIV in the home care settings. I can look for the number and send it to the person that asked for it. But at the moment, I don't have any specific number.
I am scanning the Q&A box for any more questions and I'm not seeing any come in. We still have a couple more minutes here, so I'll give folks a second to see if there are any questions that come in, but maybe give the panelists one final prod to just see if there's anything you wanted to cover or any final remarks before we close out. One final question that came in sort of open of what are some bills in either state or the federal level that we should be aware of about healthcare access? Of course, folks are aware of the federal bills that are going on, but maybe you could talk about something that are going on in your jurisdictions.
I'm in the South, so nothing good's moving. I'm I feel like there like are anti-abortion bills that are in limbo. And that was even before Texas, which sucks. But not anything good. I know like one good thing that we've been able to do in North Carolina. The governor just signed a bill that would allow pharmacists to be able to prescribe PEP, which is cool. I think that, you know, up until this point, people had to go to, you know, a physician or another healthcare provider. Some folks had to go to the ED or the ER rather to get a prescription. So that just recently happened in North Carolina. So I feel like we have one good thing going on.
I think that most of my effort has been put into aging and HIV. And I'm one of the things that, you know, I've been working in collaboration with NMAC's policy division is to get to have a congressional briefing on aging. There was one that the last one that was done, I think, was in 2009. And, you know, and that one was about, you know, just warning about what was going to happen in the, you know, in the future with this aging population. But now at this time, we do need to raise, you know, the bar again and talk about the fact that we do have aging in our, you know, in our community, and that we are half and we will become the majority. So, you know, having a congressional briefing that can inform legislators would be, you know, the beginning, right, of other legal or policy efforts that could happen. And when I say modernizing, right, and why, you know, we need to look at what are the things that we need to do in terms of policy to make sure that, you know, Ryan, why it's upgraded to the level that can provide comprehensive service to people that are aging with HIV. And that is not just an effort of a band-aid, but that is systematically through the legislation. So that's what I've been, you know, kind of my north lately.
So in Mississippi, our legislative session starts early January. So I'm not sure what the agenda is going to look like and what type of bills are going to be dropped. They're right now talking about the possibility of a special session. So we'll see about that. But I'm not sure what the agenda would be for that. There's just talk about it. So I'll let y'all know when I hear anything. And then concrete. And then we are working on, doing some advocacy, continued advocacy around Medicaid expansion on a federal level. We've been working at the Mississippi Center for Justice with the Southerners for Medicaid Expansion Coalition. We're going to continue that push until all Americans have access to healthcare.
Question came in from the chat, and I think Linda and Christina, I know y'all's answer probably, but from Robin Webb, what will ultimately be the tipping point for so-called conservative legislatures to convince them to expand Medicaid, or is there a tipping point at all?
I feel like we would have to call it something else. I think it's really, at this point, it's like a branding thing. Anything that sounds like Medicaid expansion or Obamacare or anything like that, people are turned off. But if you put a different name on it, a different label, give it a little PR refresh, I think if people don't realize it's Medicaid expansion, I think that may be the best bet. Because in North Carolina specifically, the culture has shifted so much to where there are Republicans who are showing up to protests wanting Medicaid expansion. There are legislators, Republican legislators, who are trying to reframe things and not call it Medicaid expansion, but effectively it is Medicaid expansion. So I think just being able to like rebrand it, call it something else, don't bring up Obama for whatever reason, that tends to be a trigger for some folks, but I think that could be it, that or the federal efforts.
And I agree with that. You know, the bottom line is, how do we get these folks insured? And call it what you want. it's sad that it has to be that way. That it's the politics of a name or what you would call a program that would provide access to healthcare. So that's but it is what it is.
Questions and some comments in the chat going on about what would decriminalizing sex work mean for the HIV community? What are your thoughts?
I think that probably that will demystify all the stigma, you know, that people have in terms of like sex work. And, you know, it will make sure that, you know, those that are sex workers have the same, you know, we can, you know, advocate for them to have the same kind of protections in terms of access to health, in terms of preventative care, and that, you know, that will be one step to destigmatize, you know, this community, which, you know, suffer from a lot of stigma and discrimination. And if it's legalized, that sex work, you know, that will take a layer of stigma, will normalize the situation for this part of the community.
I think that it'll help with the broader public health outcomes and consequences that exist. I think that when we think about, you know, HIV specifically, you know, a good public health strategy gets everyone in the community. Sex workers are included, you know, and I think that when you leave out a part of the population that is active with other parts of the community, it's like you're having that gap there. So I think that if we were to better engage sex workers in HIV treatment and testing, I think that'll have a ripple.
I think Christina froze mid-answer, so maybe Linda, you could pick up. Or is Christina back?
I think I'm back.
But, all right, you're back.
But I don't have anything else to add.
And I'll just add to what Christina and Moises have already stated, which is, you know, I think every member of the community should be considered in this and not, you know, take out a section of the population for any reason. And I think it helps to destigmatize HIV and, you know, it being so sexualized, it's just, you know, absurd, but it happens. And I think if we looked at it across the board and even, you know, and with sex education and what that means and looks like, I know that wasn't a direct question, but I just wanted to throw it in there. If we normalized all of this, that it would help to take away the stigma. And I think somebody put in here being punitive. Yes, it is.
We have time for maybe one more question. And there's one in the Q&A that I think the gist of it is, you know, how do populations that know they're going to face stigma at the doctor deal with that sort of thing and deal with the medical mistrust of trying to engage in the healthcare system at all and how widespread that issue is?
I think that, you know, during my generation, my time, I would just look for the doctor that looked at HIV patients and, you know, just, but not everybody has that kind of luxury, right, to select the doctors that you will have. I think that it has to be a way in which, you know, even through all these years, and how we can empower the person living with HIV to understand, you know, to be able to bring a conversation, to make that physician engage into the conversation about what does it really mean to live with HIV. And also to help them understand that how their actions hurt their patients, right? And hurt the potential of other patients being able to live, you know, fully without feeling stigmatized, without feeling, you know, ostracized from the community, or with the fear that if this is how my physician think, how is going to be my care? You know, what should I expect in terms of like the quality of the care that I will receive? So, you know, so they should be, you know, also the self-stigma and how we are empowered and we are the ones hiring these doctors, right? We are the client, if you will say. We can tell the doctor, you're not doing your job, you're fired, or you can go and, you know, kind of like report whatever he did or comment or he made you feel to the top people in your clinic, in your doctor's office, if it's a practice, you know, but we are empowered to claim that and to demand that we're treated, you know, as human beings. So my two cents.
Yes. Oh, Linda, did you want to go ahead?
You can go ahead, Christina.
Okay. Yeah, I was just going to say, like, definitely let those folks know who's in charge. I think that, you know, you are the expert of your own body. Like, don't forget that. And I think that, you know, there have been people who have gone on this journey before you. There are other folks living with HIV that you can lean on. And I heard that a lot of times, like, people in your own community tend to give you the best advice and you have that trust with them. And so I think that's why it's important for us to really empower and educate our community about, you know, best practices, what, you know, whatever questions folks have. That way people aren't in that position to where they're going into a clinic and not being able to advocate for themselves. Cause it sucks. Cause sometimes providers, you know, aren't always the best folks to reach out to for help.
Yeah, same here. I mean, I think, you know, providing people with support on how to advocate for themselves when you walk into that clinical setting or even over the telephone, that's the beginning of advocating for yourself, what you need, why you need it, and not have anybody tell you, no, you don't need a test. Well, who are you to determine whether I need it? It should be routine anyway, but if I'm asking for a test, I should get a test. And, you know, I think that discourages all type of opportunities for people to even have care that, you know, somebody's telling you what you need or don't need. So I think patients are the best advocates, you know, advocating for themselves, and they do it without even knowing it. But, you know, I think, and I think Moises may have talked about a little bit about internalized stigma, that even with that, not let that be a barrier to you getting the care that you want and deserve.
Really great answers. Looks like we've reached the end of the question and answers. So I'm gonna wrap us up here and we're almost at time too. Say thank you all for a wonderful panel discussion and thanks to those of you watching and those giving us questions to discuss throughout this panel. This has been an amazing discussion, but unfortunately we have to wrap up today's events. I'd like to thank our panelists again, as well as AIDS United and the People Living with HIV Caucus as planning partners for AIDS Watch. Thank you again for coming to today's Fall AIDS Watch, and please be sure to come back tomorrow as we discuss civil rights, voting, and racial justice. Take care, everybody.
Bye. Thank you. Good night.